Hi, I'm Al Gracian from Albopepper.com. Today's grow light market is advancing faster than ever before. We must filter out overinflated product claims. Meanwhile, we're trying to understand the various product specs and what these mean for us. What is PAR light? Do plants benefit from full spectrum light, or is red and blue all that they use? When looking at the characteristics of a light source, we can focus on two crucial aspects. First, there is light intensity, which refers to how bright a light is. This relates to the photon density. Secondly, there's light quality, which is also important. This refers to the composition of light, how much red is emitted in relation to blues, greens, or any other color. Grow lights emit radiation within the visible light spectrum. This chart, which you'll see time and again, portrays a narrow portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. Each color has its own unique wavelength, from violet to red. A specific color can be described by its wavelength in nanometers. So, a blue light may be 450 nanometers, while green is 550 and red is 680. Traveling left on this graph, towards blue, each photon or particle of light has more and more energy. Moving right towards red, each light wave possesses less energy. As you get right outside of the visible spectrum, below 400 nanometers, you have ultraviolet light. Some grow lights may produce UV in addition to visible light. And interestingly, plants have shown physiological responses to UV with improved disease and pest resistance. Between 710 and 850 nanometers, we have far red light, which plants are sensitive to as well. Far red does less to drive photosynthesis, but it can greatly affect plant development or morphology. For example, certain ratios of red to far red can tell plants that they're under a canopy of taller plants, triggering them to grow taller in response. Of course, the most crucial range for plant growth is within 400 to 700 nanometers in color range. Photons within this range are most effective at driving photosynthesis. This is referred to as PAR light, photosynthetically active radiation. Note that this range includes even green light. Wait a second, don't many growers emphasize blue and red frequencies, saying plants don't even use green light? They may refer to green as being completely wasted light. Well, for decades, researchers have demonstrated that green light serves a useful function and is capable of driving photosynthesis. In fact, recent research is revealing some unexpected benefits of green light, even helping with organic pest control. The point is, don't prescribe to the oversimplified mentality that plants only need one or two wavelengths of light to thrive. Yes, they may live and grow, but that doesn't mean that all other wavelengths are useless and unneeded. So, where did this mindset come from? Well, one thing that doesn't help is the misapplication of the photosynthesis absorption spectra. People love bringing up this little graph, which certainly makes green light appear useless. Even laying on that popular carotenoid graph still leaves a big gap. But how was this data gathered? This was based on testing of thin algal solutions. Higher plants, you know, the stuff that we're trying to grow, do not respond to and process light in the same fashion. They have much more complex structures. In reality, green leaves of land plants absorb a substantial fraction of green light. And this light then drives photosynthesis as well. So, yes, plant leaves reflect some green light, and that's why they're green. That's good, though, because this results in improved canopy penetration. But ultimately, much of that light is able to be harnessed. Should that really surprise us, though? After all, the PAR measurements used by horticulturalists give green photons the same weight as blues and reds. So really, a broad, full-spectrum light source is a good thing, not a bad thing. A spectrometer can analyze a light source, revealing the ratios of one color compared to another. Many light manufacturers will share spectral graphs of their light. It may be portrayed as a curve like this, or perhaps this. At different phases of growth, certain spectrum profiles may enhance results. Professional growers may switch bulbs as their plants mature and enter their fruiting or reproductive phase. High-pressure sodium lights are heavier in the yellow through red end of the spectrum. Meanwhile, metal halide lamps emit a larger amount of blue and UV. You may be familiar with the Kelvin rating system, which is commonly used to describe the color characteristics of fluorescent lights. Lower numbers, like 2100K, have a warm amber hue, while cooler bulbs, like 6500K, are higher in blue light. With the widespread adoption of LEDs, we do see LEDs that use a Kelvin rating, but many plant grow lights do not. Instead, they contain multiple diodes, each of which emits a unique, narrow band of color. A three-band LED, for example, may contain one type of blue and two types of red. Plants respond differently to different combinations or ratios of light. Thus, custom tuning of that perfect ratio is often sought out as one LED seller tries to stand out from the rest. LED grow lights are showing more and more color bands. Some even claim to be full spectrum. This can be achieved by including a few diodes that have a phosphor coating. That coating changes the energy state of photons from a blue diode. The result is a mixture of wavelengths that produce white light. The reliance on phosphor coatings slightly reduces an LED's efficiency rating, but it creates a more rounded spectrum that is likely to support a broad range of plant types. Light quality can have a drastic impact on plant development, affecting the shape and length of plant leaves. But just as important is the overall light intensity. What's the best way to measure light intensity when it comes to plants? Our next video will answer that question. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe if you haven't already. And as always, happy gardening.